Hello and welcome to our talk. My name is Akash. I work as an engineering manager at a firm Networks. I look after the platform layer of our product. Along with me is Nitish, who's a lead architect and a member of the office of the CTO, also at a firm. In this talk, we will present a model for stronger multi-tenancy of Kubernetes workloads that has worked well for our telco applications. In particular, we'll describe a way of deploying and using service mesh features to achieve a stronger notion of multi-tenancy. Before we dive deeper, I want to give you some background of what our tech stack looks like, as well as what our workloads are. So Affirm is a telco company. As of April 2020, we are a wholly owned subsidiary of Microsoft and a part of the Azure team in Microsoft. This is our stack built largely from CNCF projects. We use Kubernetes, of course, along with a variety of other infrastructure layer projects. On top of that, we use various CNCF projects again for our metrics framework, logging and tracing framework, as well as networking, database, and security needs. Our workloads on top of this are what are described as network functions. There's a body called 3GPP, which comes up with specifications for how a mobile core software network should behave like. And we build software solutions which are as per those specifications. Now, each one of these boxes that you see on top, AMF, SMF, UPF, these are composed of between 5 to 15 different microservices and have different roles to play in the telco network. At a very high level, these microservices and these network functions as a whole help in the call setup, routing, and accounting process of our everyday consumer 5G phone calls and data calls, right? So with that background, let me dive right to the heart of the matter. Namespaces. Multi-tenancy starts in Kubernetes with the notion of namespaces, right? In a if you're looking at running a Kubernetes cluster which is shared by multiple teams or by multiple application groups, or for applications which are started for multiple customers, you would separate them using Kubernetes namespaces, right? What you do there is separate the, provide a namespace for each of the Kubernetes objects that you deploy in the cluster, right? These objects could be deployments, stateful sets, services, horizontal pod auto scaling objects, and so on. It's a neat way to separate out logically the boundaries of different parts of your applications. But beyond just prettifying your kubectl output, they don't really serve any other purpose unless you start using or defining some of the namespaced controls that Kubernetes also offers, right? So we'll go over some of the basic controls which are namespaced in Kubernetes first. So the first control that we have is role-based access control. For every namespace, you can define different roles, users, groups, and service accounts through which you can, for example, control which set of users or groups can create, delete, or watch for different types of Kubernetes objects. Here we show an example where a user belonging to the green group can only access objects that are created in the green group namespace, but not in the orange group namespace, right? Similarly, for every software or every microservice, in some ways, every container that runs on Kubernetes can be attached to a service account which are attached to role-based access control as well. So you can, in a sense, control which software or human components can interact with which other software or human components through these role-based access control objects, right? One thing to note here, of course, is that these RBAC controls are only for Kubernetes resources, right? So for example, you can't control through these mechanisms the traffic pattern, right? So you can't control which external entities can send traffic to which entity using purely Kubernetes RBAC controls. For that, there is a construct called network policy in Kubernetes. It's defined by base Kubernetes itself, but implemented via the CNI route, right? So depending on which CNI you route, you use, for example, Calico or various other CNIs, you can define different network policies and restrict which incoming and outgoing on an incoming and outgoing basis, which layer 3 and layer 4 aspects are accessible. For example, you can specify which ports and protocols and IP addresses are allowed to be accessed on a namespace basis from outside, right? So in this example, you can set the policies for namespace 1 and namespace 2 separately. You can even do things like namespace 2, containers in namespace 2 can access objects in namespace 1, but not vice versa, right? So these are layer 3 and layer 4 constructs through which you can control the network traffic between namespaces, as well as what's coming from outside into the cluster and what's going from the cluster outside the cluster, right? So this provides a fairly strong way of controlling at a very base layer 3, layer 4 mechanisms, right? What we found though was that we need more. We need some more constructs on top of the RBAC and network policies that we were using already. What we found we needed were layer 7 traffic policies per tenant, right? We wanted to define, for example, a rate limit for the amount of traffic that we want to accept on a per tenant basis, right? We also want to define security on a per tenant basis for incoming traffic. For example, things like MTLS that we use, which is mandated actually by the standards body for every network functions in our use case, right? So we want to be able to specify which source of truth is accepted for each of the tenant, right? What it boils down to is different root certificates were needed for different tenants in the same Kubernetes cluster. We also want to provide mechanisms to do both JWT-based authentication as well as OAuth 2.0-based authorization on a per-tenant basis as well. And lastly, we want to do observability and accounting and auditing on a per-tenant basis as well. We looked at the available solution and found that service meshes offer a lot based on what we required from the list in the last slide, right? So service meshes, you would have seen it being used for a variety of use cases. Observability and TLS are the primary use cases, but we found that even for this multi-tenancy use case, service meshes do provide a lot of tools and features that we could readily make use of. Right, so as soon as we introduce a service mesh in our cluster, we can do policy based on a namespace basis. For example, we can specify which namespaces must have MTLS enabled within the namespace and which namespaces do not need to have MTLS, for example, right? But we found that the most common way of deploying service meshes, irrespective of which specific service mesh you deploy, there were some common deployment models, right? Parts of those models were that there is a control plane element and that's deployed in its own namespace. Here we show that in a blue namespace, right? Also, the full service mesh and all namespaces within the cluster were connected into one single namespace. One single service mesh, right? So we have different namespaces, but as far as the service mesh is concerned, they sort of behave like a one single mesh, right? Also, there are elements in the service mesh which are shared by elements of the multiple namespaces. For example, it's a common deployment model where we have an ingress gateway running in the service mesh control plane namespace, which acts as the gateway for incoming traffic for traffic across different namespaces, right? So traffic enters through this single gateway and gets distributed to microservices that are deployed in multiple other namespaces, right? So we found that this typical model of deployment of this service mesh didn't work for us, and we wanted some more out of it, right? So specifically what we needed were these 4 points. We first of all didn't want any shared path for any incoming or outgoing request from these multiple tenants that were deployed in different namespaces. Secondly, we wanted automated and independent scaling of any gateways that were involved, right? So if the traffic of a certain tenant is increasing rapidly, we didn't want that to affect the traffic or the distribution of the traffic in other tenants. Thirdly, we wanted all the traffic from a given tenant, the topology, the internal topology of a given tenant to be hidden from even other tenants, right? So even when traffic is crossing tenant boundaries, we didn't want entities in tenant 2, for example, to be aware of how many pod instances are there in tenant 1's namespace, right? So that wasn't really there with the standard deployment model. Lastly, we still want to share some common control aspects of the service mesh itself. We didn't want to create a whole independent service mesh per tenant because of the amount of overhead it adds on a per tenant basis, right? So we still want to share as much as possible the control plane aspects of the service mesh, but have isolation in all these other aspects that we mentioned before. So what we came up with was a model which sort of looks like a mesh inside a mesh. This model consists of an ingress gateway and an egress gateway deployed per namespace or per tenant basis. So you have ingress egress gateway along with all sidecar based proxies in the workloads of each tenant. Here we show again the green workload and the orange workload, and you can see all the blue colored entities are controlled by the same control plane elements of the service mesh, but they are independent instances of the ingress gateway and the egress gateway. So if you look at end-to-end traffic from external traffic, whether it's client traffic coming from outside the tenant application, or if it's traffic leaving the tenant application and going outside to an external server. All the traffic is completely independent per tenant and shares no common elements between tenants in this model. In the demo part of the talk, we'll show the use cases, how we achieve the points that we mentioned above, specifically how we can control the policies, the traffic policies on a per tenant basis using this mesh in a mesh way of deploying service mesh. So with that, I'll hand it over to Nitish, who will go over this model and show what it can help us achieve. Thanks.
Thanks, Akash. Hey guys, my name is Nitish Malhotra. I am a technology architect at Affirm Networks. I focus on cloud native technologies and their applications to the 5G domain. Prior to this, I worked with Akash and I focused on applying service meshes to our solution. Okay, so in the interest of time, let's jump straight into the demo. This service mesh pattern can apply to every service mesh, but for our demo, we've used Istio. So let's begin by installing the Istio control plane. Here you can see that I have disabled the global ingress gateway and the egress gateway in our Istio system namespace, because we plan to use gateways at our namespace boundaries, at the tenant boundaries. Okay, let's go ahead and kick this off. While Istio control plane gets installed, I'm gonna show you a quick picture of what application we will be using. So we're gonna use the sample app from the Istio repository. This is the book info app, and you have a set of microservices, a front-end product page, and you have the review service, the detail service, and the rating service, everything coming together to provide some information about the book. And this is what the front end would look like. Okay, so I think our control plane should be up and running. Next, we're gonna create our namespaces just to demonstrate the multi-tenancy solution. So let's create tenant one. Sorry about that. Let's create tenant one, and we're gonna label our tenant with Istio injection equal to enabled, and this enables automatic sidecar injection for all the workload pods that spin up in this namespace. Okay, there we have that. Let's go ahead and deploy our application along with the gateways to this namespace. So all the relevant resources are being deployed. We can quickly take a look at tenant one and the deployments. Great, so we have our book info app, we have the ratings deployment, we have the product page deployment, reviews, and details. Product page is what we will try to talk to. In addition, we also have both our gateways in this namespace, so I think it should be ready by now. Okay, we're gonna run through the same steps for tenant two, and shouldn't take too long. Okay, while this is coming up, I'd also like to note at this point, in a real cluster that wants to support multi-tenancy, the administrators would set up resource quotas and are back using service accounts for these namespaces. So this is how it's traditionally done, and Akash spoke about this, and we're going to show what else can we add on top using service meshes to make it more secure and improve the multi-tenancy of a cluster. Okay, I think by now we should have our application up and running. Great, so we have everything up and running. I'm gonna quickly show you what this looks like in the graphical dashboard that Istio provides us. It's called Kiali. Let's quickly refresh this this view. So now we can see that we have our gateways deployed. we're looking at both the namespaces. So we have our ingress gateway, our egress gateway, and both of the namespaces have their relevant microservices that are now part of the mesh. You won't see any graph edges right now because we haven't sent any traffic. And at a later stage in the demo, we'll start seeing the edges and the traffic flowing from the ingress gateway to the application. Okay, so let's jump back. We have everything ready. We're looking at Kiali. Now I'm gonna quickly ensure that this sample app comes up. I'm using the insecure port, and these are exposed on node port 31080 for tenant 1 and 32080 for tenant 2. So looks like it's reachable. We can do the same thing for 32080. Perfect, that went through as well. So now let's jump to Postman, and what I'm going to be demonstrating is one of the features that Akash has spoken about, and this is the transport authentication using Mutual TLS. For those of you who are not familiar with Mutual TLS but understand TLS, in addition, so all Mutual TLS does is, in addition to the client verifying the server certificate, making sure it's signed by a trusted CA, the server does the same for client certificates, so making it a little more secure. And this is something that's enabled by default within the service mesh as well as of Istio 1.6. So let's send a request to our tenant 1 at the secure port. Again, we've set the node port, so 31443 is the HTTPS port for tenant 1, and 32443 is going to be the HTTPS port for our tenant 2. The way we configure the certificates in Postman is through some global settings. I have set the certs and keys for both our tenants, tenant clients, in Postman, and we have the relevant service certificates already uploaded to our ingress gateways in each of the tenant namespaces. So let's go ahead and try to reach the product page through Postman. I have the header set for tenant 1 to tenant1.example.com. This is something that will be compared for authentication. So let's go ahead, send the request. Takes a few seconds and there we go. That's the HTML page that we saw earlier. Obviously I can't do it over here because I don't have the certificates loaded, but this is essentially what it is returning back to us. Let's try the same thing with tenant 2. Header set to tenant 2 example.com, and we're going to send the request. Alright, I just wanted to go back to the certificates and show you that these are two separate certificates. We have tenant 1 using t1cert.pem, and we have tenant 2 using t2cert.pem, and both of them are signed by their own individual keys. Okay, so this is how we are accomplishing Mutual TLS. So I want to show this on Kiali as well as the traffic flows. So I'm just going to send a couple of requests so that Kiali can start populating its graph. Okay, I think that should be good. Let's go back to Kiali, and there we go. So now we see that the traffic is flowing. We send messages to the ingress gateway, we send messages to the egress gateway, the ingress gateway for tenant 2, and we can see how the traffic is coming in through the egress gateway, and it's flowing through the different components of the book info application. So yeah, this is cool. The egress gateway can be used for redirecting traffic out of the namespace. In this demo, we haven't shown that, but it is pretty much symmetrical to how we've set up the ingress gateway. The application pods, when trying to read services outside their namespace, are gonna redirect all the traffic through the egress gateway and talk to the external services, or namespace external services for that matter. And the last case where I wanna show a failure that I'm inducing in here is when tenant 1 tries to ask for a tenant to against his own ingress gateway. So what we see here is that the ingress gateway returns an error. We have the ingress gateway reporting that the subject alternative names did not contain the request that we made for tenant two. So this is one component of achieving multi-tenancy using the service mesh pattern. Like I said, you can use JWT tokens for origin authentication. This is something supported by different gateways. In Istio, it's the ingress gateway. I suppose Ambassador would do the same, or any of the other gateways that are used with the service meshes out there. In addition to both the authentication types, you can also use the OAuth2 feature that the gateways provide. And Istio Ingress Gateway gives you OAuth2 using JWT. It's something we kept out of this demo just so that we can finish this in time. But this is now an added security level over what we traditionally saw with network policies and RBAC using service accounts. So yeah, there's more that can be done. I'm pretty sure there'll be more features using extensions for these gateways where you can perform more security features and essentially hide your tenant topology. All right, thanks guys. That's it for me. And hope you guys enjoyed this presentation and hope you learned something out of it. Thank you. Have a good day.